Way back in 2013, Jan Willem Niemann gave a talk about the art of Screenshake. At the time, he was the co-owner of Vlambeer with Rami Ishmael, although he's now the sole owner. Vlambeer's success is often attributed to their mastery of game juice, or how the game feels to play. Lots of Vlambeer's games were coded in GameMaker, and luckily for us, we have access to the source code for a demo which JW presented at that talk. In this video, I'm going to look closely at 10 parts of the GameMaker project so that you can learn how to juice up your player, enemies, guns, and combat. Obviously, the code was written in an old version of GameMaker over 10 years ago, and probably written in a short space of time, so don't expect the code to be perfect, but there is something to be said for the fact that it's complete and playable, even with some cut corners. There are quite a few places where I've modified the code just to be more readable, but not to change how it actually functions. The first aspect we're going to look at is Muzzle Flash. Muzzle Flash is the light which is created at the end of a gun when it's fired. Movies often exaggerate this effect because it looks impressive and powerful. When it's implemented in a game, the impact is just as strong, even though the code is really simple. The first step will be to create a bullet sprite with two frames. The first frame should be a large white circle, and the second frame can be the actual bullet sprite. According to JW, you should avoid making the bullet a realistic size. It won't look like a Vlambeer game unless the bullet is the size of the player's chest. Then all you want to do is display the first image at the precise frame when the gun is fired and switch to the next image the frame after. JW does this by adding an animation end event, which is triggered anytime the sprite has looped through all of the frames. In here, he sets the image speed to 0 and the image index to 1, which means that the animation will end and remain on the second frame until it's destroyed. When the bullet is destroyed, you'll want to add some sort of bullet impact effect. Even if the enemy has its own animation for getting hit by a bullet, you need something separate that will play whenever the bullet hits anything, like a wall, which doesn't react on its own. The first step in making this is drawing out a simple 3-frame impact animation. Then we can make an object and assign the impact sprite to it. In the wall collision event of the bullet object, have the bullet move itself to the edge of the wall and then destroy itself. Then it can create the bullet impact object and set the image angle of the new object to the image angle of the existing bullet so that the impact faces the same direction as the bullet. Then in the impact object, JW sets the speed of the impact animation in the create event, and in the animation event, he just destroys the impact object. Another cool thing that JW does with the bullets is he makes each bullet travel in a slightly different direction, even if the player is aiming in the exact same place. This adds some variety to the visuals of the game, but it also adds some depth to the combat, because you can have guns which are more or less accurate. JW achieves this by first creating a bullet and setting its horizontal speed to the direction the player is facing, multiplied by how many pixels the bullet should travel each frame. Then, because GameMaker can determine the direction in which the bullet is traveling, JW adds a random number between -6 and +6 to the direction and sets the image angle of the bullet to its direction, so that it's rotated towards the direction in which it's moving. Now we've covered the bullets, so let's spend a bit of time polishing our guns. The first step will be to add a bit of delay to the gun movement, so that it lags behind the player's movement ever so slightly. This effect gives the gun a feeling of weight, and adds a bit of life to the sprite, which otherwise has no animation. JW's method for doing this is incredibly simple. Instead of drawing the machine gun at the player's exact Y position, he draws it at the Y previous position. This is a built-in variable in GameMaker, which just tracks the Y position that the player was in the previous frame. This means that as the player's movement accelerates, the gun is accelerating just one frame behind the player. This is a case where there's better ways to code this, for example with the lerp function, where you get more control over the result, but when you see the footage of JW's demo, you would never say that this effect looks bad. In the same draw event, you can see that JW is subtracting a variable called WepX from the X position at which he's drawing the gun. This means that when WepX is 0, the gun is drawn at the player's position, but when WepX is greater than 0, it is drawn from just behind the player. At the bottom of this event is a line of code which takes away 0.25 from WepX until it's less than or equal to 0. This WepX variable is getting set in the X key down event, which is where we're triggering the creation of the bullet. Here, you can see that all JW does is set WepX to 3 when a bullet is created. This means that every time the player shoots, the gun gets pushed back 3 pixels for about 12 frames. The effect that this creates is that the gun has some kick, And just this 3-pixel movement gives the impression that the gun is very strong, physically impacting the player. Speaking of impacting the player, we'll probably want the player to get moved back a little bit every time they shoot to simulate some gun recoil. Another thing that JW says is you should always give the player a reason not to be pressing the shoot button. In this case, the reason is that you'll get pushed back while you're shooting. Again, this effect is very easy to code. All JW does is check if the player is shooting, and if there's no solid object in the direction opposite to the direction the player is facing, and then move the player 1 pixel in that direction. That's everything I'm going to cover for the player, so let's move on to the enemies. The first thing we want to do is give the enemies an animation that will play when they get hit. If our enemy sprite looks like this, our enemy hit sprite can be as simple as this 2-frame animation. Because the first frame is solid white, it makes the impact of the bullet really clear to the player. Then what we're going to have to do is go to the bullet object and open the enemy collision event. The first thing we're doing here is calling the function scrhurt. If we open up that function, one of the things it's doing is setting the enemy sprite to sprEnemyHurt. Then once that animation has played out, the animation end event will trigger in the enemy object. Inside that animation end event, the sprite says that if the sprite is the hurt sprite, at the end of the animation, it will be set back to the enemy sprite. Of course, we want a unique effect for the death of an enemy as opposed to it just losing 1 HP. For this, when the enemy dies, we can spawn a corpse object. So first create a sprite for the corpse. This can be just a simple 3-frame animation, which ends with the enemy lying on the floor. Then create a corpse object and assign it to the sprite you just created. Next, add a destroy event in the enemy object. This event gets triggered when the enemy object stops existing. What we can do in here is create a corpse object at the same place as the enemy object, which is about to disappear. Then we'll set the right variable of the corpse, which controls its direction, to be the opposite of the right variable of the player. We'll also set its vertical speed to be the vertical speed of the enemy, -3. This means that the corpse will spawn and be knocked backwards into the air. In the same destroy event of the enemy object where we just spawned the corpse object, we can also occasionally spawn an explosion. So first create an explosion sprite. This is just going to be a 2-frame animation of a large circle turning from black to white. Second, create an explosion object and assign this sprite to it. The main things you need to set up in this object are the create event, the enemy collision event, and the animation end event. In the animation end event, just destroy the instance because we want the explosion to disappear after the white frame. In the create event, the main thing is that you set the speed of the animation, add some screen shake, and play an explosion sound effect. Then in the enemy collision event, you can just call the function scrhurt again. So finally, going back to the destroy event of the enemy object, we can say if random3 is less than 1, then create the explosion object. This logic first generates a random number between 1 and 3 and then checks if it's less than 1. What this means in effect is that there's a 1 in 4 chance of the explosion spawning. Now I'm going to briefly cover the basics behind the camera system. Essentially, the camera should be positioned a little in front of wherever the player is looking, so that the thing they're aiming at is closer to the center of the screen. Also, we can create some screen shake by adding some randomness to the position of the camera based on a shake variable. I've had to stray quite a bit from the exact code JW used, just because GameMaker has changed the way its cameras work quite a bit, but what the code does is exactly the same. We start in the player's create event with the variables viewX, viewY, addX, and addY. These represent the position of the camera view and how much we'll offset the camera by. Then in the step event, from the add position, we want to take away the add position minus our offset value, all multiplied by 0.1, which is going to smoothly reposition our camera. Then we can interpolate the view values in the same way. And finally, we'll use the function camera_set_view_pos to set the position of the view. Inside this function, we can also add our screen shake by just adding random range negative shake to positive shake, which will generate a random decimal negative positive number based on whatever shake is set to. The last thing I'm going to talk about is the sleep function that JW uses pretty frequently throughout the code. Vlambeer is well known for their love of impact frames, which is where the entire game pauses for a few frames whenever there's been a big impact. In older versions of GameMaker, there used to be a function called sleep, which would pause the entire game, but it wasn't a very good implementation as it would literally just stop the program from running, and that could cause some errors and mess up some calculations. It also means that in some of Vlambeer's games, such as Nuclear Throne, if the sleep function is called loads of times, then the game will pause for a ridiculous amount of time. So you may have seen that I've commented out the sleep function in my copy of the project. The better way to implement this, although it is more involved, is to have a variable called sleep, which is initially set to 0. Then, when there's an impact, you can set it to the number of frames you want to pause for, and in every object that you want to pause, wrap all of the code which you want to stop from running during the pause in an if statement that checks if sleep is less than or equal to 0. With that feature covered, my whirlwind tour of JW's code is done. If you've enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe, and if this does well, I can make a full tutorial for how I'd make this demo with some more modern coding practices and taking advantage of modern GameMaker's features. I hope you leave this video with some insight into Vlambeer's development process and have learned something for your next project. If there's anything I could have explained better, please leave a comment. Otherwise, just like, subscribe, and hit the bell.